Tim.
It's the morning star drive 117.8. You soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the morning star drive, you know.
Hey guys, how's it going? It's Thursday, May 12th. And this is the Morningstar Drive on 117.8. We're on YouTube, so make sure to subscribe, follow us on SoundCloud, and make sure to support us on Patreon. So what is happening today on this wonderful Thursday? We've got current news from around the world, question and answer Thursday, and of course, the Thoughts of the Week segment, and this week's on Being Afraid of God. All right, everyone, how are you doing today? It is Thursday. It's almost the ending of the week. Hope you really enjoyed the service last night, so let's get this day started together here on the Morningstar Drive. Just want to remind everyone, keep liking, commenting, build the community. Let's make sure we have a place for all of us here in the English-speaking world of Providence that we can come together and, you know, talk about the things we want to talk about or, you know, testify. All those are the different things. I hope that we can do it in this community channel, all right? So for me, I had this really crazy experience this morning after I worked out. So I worked out every day around 7 a.m. and I just got back from working out, and I'm eating my breakfast, TV's on, whatever it is, and I just had this thought, this inspiration that came to my mind is like, do you really know what life will be like after you die, like when you go to heaven? And it wasn't a negative thought, not negative at all, but it just made me think about how much I don't really envision the world after I die. Because, you know, we're living in this physical world, right? And in this physical life, it's easy only to look at this life, but not to think anything at all about the life that comes after. Like, if I were to ask you guys too, you can comment this, you can comment below too, is can you envision it? Can you really envision what life is like? Or can you only really think about the reality that's in front of you right now? Which is kind of weird because the true reality is the spiritual world that lasts forever. So imagine if you died right now, like what would heaven, like can you even imagine what heaven would be like? Like it's going to be more real than what we see right now, which is incredible. I'm like, what? It's going to be more real than this? And it's hard to think like, wow. That's going to be the real life after, but I can't even imagine what heaven's going to be like. I can't even imagine myself in heaven. Like, what would it be like being in heaven? So I was trying really hard to think about what would my life be like after I die. Like, you know, of course, we're thinking to ourselves, like, all the lessons we've learned is after you die, and then the angels take you to heaven or the golden city. And I was like, man, if I'm up there, imagine you're living there for eternity, what would you think about your life on earth? Like, what would you actually, like, say to yourself? Like, oh, I should have done better. Oh, why did you do it like that? Oh, if you only knew it was like this, we could have been in a much better place. It's like, man. And I kind of had this vision, not a real vision, but I was envisioning it in my head what my life would be like in heaven. But it's just so hard to think about life, like real life beyond what I see where I am right now, you know, in my bedroom with the floor, walls, curtains, you know, a computer and all these other different things. Like, wow, how different would that really, really be? So, oh man, it was kind of trippy for me. And I thought to myself, like, wow, that's a really interesting thought to have at this time. So I don't know, have you guys ever thought about that type of thing? Like, what would life actually be like in heaven? Like, what would you actually be seeing or feeling? And in my head, when I start to envision it, it became so real to me. I was kind of like, man, you have to start living for the real life, which happens after. And, you know, it's that delayed gratification that all those things that I want right now, all those things that I desire and want is not necessarily the best thing for my future. So I was just, yeah, it was just kind of an interesting experience that I had. It was just right after working out, and maybe because I was tired, but it was like my spirit was like working overtime, like, dude, you know what you're doing, right? I'm like, yeah, what should I be doing right now? So quite interesting. But yeah, super happy about all the things that are happening right now for me and the things that are moving as I move towards, you know, my next mission or what I should do next. It is Question and Answer Thursday. So Question and Answer Thursday is quite interesting because I got two questions. And the first one is coming from Australia. And the question is about a part of a scripture in regards to the resurrection lesson. And that's Matthew chapter 27, verse 50 to 54, which is Jesus cried out again in a loud voice, gave up his spirit. And at that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rock split. And the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." So the question from this verse is, do you know what Sun Tzu taught about in this verse, and how does it relate to 1 Corinthians 15:20 that says, "But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep." And then they said they were wondering if it was people's spirits who died before Jesus, or was it metaphorical for those who were spiritually dead and now believed? And also, in relation to Isaiah 26:19, "But your dead," you know, that says, I use this in resurrection a lot, "but your dead will live, their bodies will rise. Let those who dwell in the dust wake up and shout for joy. Your dew is like the dew in the morning," right? So there, that first question is going to all be about the resurrection, focusing on Matthew 27, 50 to 54. Okay, and then the second question is very interesting because it's a new member or a newcomer asking about the book of Deuteronomy, especially chapter 22, verse 28 and 29. It talks about a man who meets a virgin and rapes her, right? And this woman is not pledged to be married, so she's not married, right? Must pay the father 50 shekels, right? Must marry this person and never divorce. So the question that kind of comes up is how can God allow this raped woman to be sold to the man who raped her, right? And, how can Moses write this? How can the prophet write this? That, you know, it's kind of weird that this is written in the Bible that a raped woman must be sold to the man who is, you know, who actually raped her. And, they also brought up that it was written in the Quran and also in, like, the Satanic Bible and stuff, too. Like, very, very similar things, so... that's quite interesting, and we'll get into those two questions, and which are really could become very, very like, oh my gosh, I can't believe that's happened, you know what I mean? But definitely very, very good questions, so we're going to go over those during the question-answer session. Tonight, we also have a new video on the Espresso with Sky channel. Why does God keep repeating things in the Bible, right? Why does he have to keep repeating things? And that would be a cool one for your newcomers and for you to take a look at too. These are all principles that Sun Tzu has taught. And of course, Sunday edition was Ines Hing from Germany this week. Go ahead and check out that interview. And next week, we're going to be heading all the way over to Malaysia. So I hope you guys will enjoy that one also. All right. So let's get into some member artists from around the world. Today, feature arts of the day. This first song is from Kumachung from Japan. And he wrote this song for 316 this year, and this is a remake of The Greatest Blessing, but it's a 2022 version. And then we'll get into Dire Wings from Korea with their latest single, We're Going Up Now, and that came out on 316. And then last but not least, we have the Sumney Boys from America with one of my favorite songs right now. It is Alone I Pray. 1, 2, 3, 4.
ただ確信して、ずっと愛想感謝が溢れる死の栄光。どんなに険しい道のりでも果てない壁に阻まれても It's fly away, fly away, yeah. 天高く 白鳥を目指す観覧の波が押し寄せてもこんなに愛が溢れてるから立ち上がれ立ち上がれ、yeah、一人じゃないパオが主の愛とその恵み忘れないで御言葉を行って御言葉を通し全てに勝って主の軍隊となり黄金の城へ前進する。主と共に溢れる祝福をくださった、惜しみなくくださった、主に感謝する。永遠に主のそばで生きられる夢ではない現実主を愛します。最高の祝福をくださった心は天国です、感謝します。主と輝く歴史なそう私を使ってください、愛してます、愛してます。
Nobody can describe me, I know who I am. 정해지는 명 따윈이지 않아, I don't care. All limitations are set by yourself.
내 길이 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 전에 오늘 정해져 있는 길이라고 누가 말했어요? Oh, 어느 길을 가든 내가 선택하면 가는 거지. 앞에도 있는 누가 지켜줄게.
난 배우고 알았으니 자유로움이 벅차오르니, yeah. 날개가 돋아나네, I'm thinking. 거기에 도착해 내 덕분에.
I can't help loving myself. 나만의 diamonds and 나만의 crown. One who wants to wear the crown. Wear the crown, then wear the crown.
We're going up now.
Keep going, that's right. Keep moving, that's right. You ready? Be strong. We're going up now.
Keep going, that's right. Keep moving, that's right. You ready? Be strong. We're going up now.
뭣도 모르고 뭣도 모르는 것들 법을 모르니 덫에 걸린 적들 있지. 난 달라 달라 달로만을 찾지 않아. 성공 보지 just do it. 내 자신을 kill it. 매세로 태어나 아닌 그냥 자연스럽게 그리 살지 정해. 아니 연속된 굴레에서 벗어나 새롭게 깨어나.
그냥 나를 지피틀거리던데 좀 더 예쁜 톤으로 좀 더 나를 튀어나오고 만들어 myself. 대하들어 오랜만에 내 뜰을 붙거든. 걸면 흘러졌으면 watch. 나도 변화가고 싶다매 그럼 너부터 만든다매 둘러봐 새롭지게 맨땀에 졸았어도 밤에도 빛나는 다이아몬드.
Myself, so bless me in the morning hours. All the demons test me, but they will never shake me. If I pray, they hate me. If I pray, you love me. Connect with you is the only thing that matters. And honestly, I couldn't be happier. While I'm praying on my knees, I trust you with all my heart. For you always come through for myself, for my family. myself alone, I pray. Please don't let me down, Lord. I know I can trust you with all my heart. So I'm on my knees, praying for you to always come through. Even if I pray all night, all I want is for your will be done. So I'm on my knees, praying for you to always come through.
I pray to never just settle for good when great is available. Who's the mastermind behind this mind? I give all the credit to God, that's why I'm back. They mad that I made it, I know that the Satans, they hate it. I keep working hard just to make progress. Now I'm on 10, trust in the process, ayy. Licking my efforts lately, I'm setting conditions daily. I'm praying on my knees, so bless me. Please bless me, please bless me. Tribulations always come and go, I will never stop, just always know. Your focus determines reality, stay solid, that's why
I'm praying on my knees, I trust you with all my heart. For you to always come through, for myself, for my family, on myself alone I pray.
Please don't let me down, Lord, I know I can trust you with all my heart. So I'm on my knees, you to always come through. Even if I pray all night, all I want is for your will be done. So I'm on my knees, praying for you to always come through.
And there it is. That is the Sumney Boys from America with a very, very pertinent song that really ties into what is happening right now in the world. That is Alone I Pray. That also dropped on 316, just like the other song from Dio Wings, We're Going Up Now. And of course, that feature artist of the day, that is Kumachung from Japan with the Greatest Blessing 2022 version. Okay, so let us get into some news going on around the world. Super important for all of us. And the top three reasons, just like Sunseem says, number one is we need to see what God is doing. Number two is we need to report and pray for those things that we see on, in the world news. And of course, some of the atrocious and terrible things that are happening, we're able to comfort God's heart. And also, so I hope that all of us here too will be able to listen to the news with that heart in mind. So let's begin with the most important thing. This news is going all around the world right now. It's the Russian-Ukraine crisis. So let's just see the things that we've missed over the last 24 hours. So UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson has signed a security declaration with Sweden and Finland, pledging support should their militaries come under attack. The PM has been visiting both countries as they consider joining the NATO Defense Alliance. Now, Russia has warned there will be consequences if they join NATO, whose members see an attack on one as an attack on all. But both Sweden and Finland, which have a long history of wartime neutrality, have seen public support for joining NATO since Russia's invasion of Ukraine. And meanwhile, pro-Russian authorities in Kherson, that's in southern Ukraine, will ask President Putin for the region to become a part of Russia, state news agencies are reporting. And Ukraine says it will redirect the flow of natural gas to avoid a key eastern transit point from Russia to Europe. U.S. intelligence is reporting that Vladimir Putin is preparing for a long war in the Ukraine, with even victory in the east potentially not ending the conflict. The warning comes as fierce fighting continues in the east, where Russia is trying to take territory. Moscow refocused its troops on capturing the Donbas region after Ukraine resisted attempts to take its capital, Kyiv. But despite this, its forces remain in a stalemate. U.S. intelligence says Avril Haines, who is the director of national intelligence, told the U.S. Senate committee hearing on Tuesday that Putin was still intending to achieve goals beyond the Donbass, but also he is facing a mismatch between his ambitions and Russia's current conventional military capabilities. However, the Russian president could turn to more drastic means as the war continues, although Moscow would only use nuclear weapons if Putin perceived an existential threat to Russia. So Defense Intelligence Agency Director Scott Barrier also told in the same hearing that the Russians and the Ukrainians were at a bit of a stalemate. So in the latest fighting, Ukraine claims to have recaptured four settlements in the northeastern Kharkiv region. So that is kind of the summary of things happened over the last 24 hours, which is kind of crazy. Like, every 24 hours, there's something new. So I hope that listening to this Russia-Ukraine news, we're able to pray much better about it also. So let's move over to Hong Kong. And of course, we know they're under China, you know, new national security law and such. But here's something crazy that happened. There's the cardinal of the Catholic Church there, Joseph Zen, is arrested under China's security law. So one of the Catholic Church's most senior members has been arrested in Hong Kong for breaking China's national security law, police have confirmed. Cardinal Joseph Zen, who is 90 years old, is one of four people detained for being associated with a now defunct organization that helped protesters in financial need. The others are a canto pop singer and actor Denise Ho, ex-legislator Margaret Ng, and academic Dr. Hui Po Kung. Now, they are accused of colluding with foreign forces, and if they are found guilty, they could face life in prison. Human Rights Watch called it a shocking new low for Hong Kong. Hong Kong police told the BBC that the group was suspected of appealing to foreign countries or organizations to impose sanctions on Hong Kong, hence threatening China's national security. Cardinal Zen fled Shanghai for Hong Kong after the communists took over China 70 years ago and is a former bishop of Hong Kong. And he has long been a critic of the government in Beijing, speaking out for Catholics in mainland China and for more democracy in Hong Kong. He once even publicly admonished the Vatican for selling out to China by forcing bishops to retire in favor of replacements picked by Beijing. The Vatican is concerned about the cardinal's arrest, spokesman Matteo Bruni said in a statement. So that is quite big, too, that they're arresting like a clergy right now for asking. Yeah, you know, I'm not sure what the next step is going to be, but Hong Kong seems like it is in control by China now. And the more, you know, we just had an election over there. Carrie Lam stepped down and they voted for someone. It's not voted by the public. It's voted by like the Senate or like the Congress. And there was only one person that was, there was only one candidate. So who else would you vote for? So it's quite crazy that you know, that is the direction where Hong Kong is going, which means they need a lot of prayers. That we have a church over there also. Which moves us into, you know, some more China news. Shanghai moves to impose the tightest restrictions yet because of COVID. So this is crazy, guys. Shanghai officials will over the next few days, further restrict access to food and hospitals in some parts of the city, the most severe phase of its extended lockdown yet. Commercial food deliveries are not allowed, and access to hospitals for all but emergencies must first be approved. So neighbors of COVID-19 cases and others living close by are also being forced into government quarantine facilities. Shanghai is now in its seventh week of citywide restrictions. Confirmed cases have fallen significantly from their peak, but authorities have not yet been able to hit the target of societal zero, right? So they're basically wanting no cases reported outside of quarantine facilities, which is kind of ridiculous, but this is what they want. Despite the toughest measures, Shanghai officials insist that people living in half the city's districts are now free to leave their homes and walk around. State media has shown propaganda videos of departing medical workers visiting city landmarks together and taking photographs. Yeah, so we know it's propaganda, right? Official notices from local committees of the ruling Communist Party seen by the BBC detail several restrictions imposed under what officials call silent periods for the next 3 days. These include only permitting government food deliveries, not allowing residents to step out of their front doors, and requiring approval from the committee for anyone other than emergency cases to access hospitals. The BBC is already aware of some cases where residents have had difficulties in getting emergency ambulances to come quickly, with some patients forced to use private cars to get to a hospital. Authorities have also stepped up measures aimed at people who live close to positive cases, even if these close contacts test negative. So what does that mean? They are sweeping up large groups of people in apartment buildings who live on the same floor or even just in the same building as those who've tested positive. So footage has also emerged on social media showing extreme disinfection taking place inside homes where people have been removed after testing positive. Widespread use of industrial scale disinfection has been a key tactic used by authorities. State censors have moved quickly to remove questions about the legality of the disinfection and also of the moving large numbers of people from their homes despite testing negative. In some cases, people who've been removed from their homes and taken into central quarantine have been told to leave a key to their home, usually in the door, so officials can come in and disinfect the space. Some legal figures have questioned if this move is constitutional. So a constitutional law professor based in Shanghai had earlier posted an open letter online stating that forcing residents into quarantine centers required state council approval or new laws passed by the legislature, and his post was quickly taken down. So as concern over food supplies grow, city officials said they would remove anyone living in temporary accommodation on the streets or in vacant buildings, placing them into closed loop management, which means that employees have to live as well as work at their offices or factories, which is crazy, right? This measure is likely to target app-based delivery drivers, who are vital for maintaining the supply chain to almost 25 million people living there. And many of these drivers currently live in temporary accommodation as they fear being locked down somewhere permanent and therefore being unable to do their job. The tightened measures come just days after China's President Xi Jinping reiterated his commitment to the controversial zero COVID strategy. And in a paper published in the health journal, The Lancet, earlier this week, senior Chinese health officials said the lockdown would buy time to vaccinate more people. Their comments come after the head of the World Health Organization called China's zero COVID strategy unsustainable. So if you want to know what China's like right now with the vaccinations and such, more than 2 years after COVID-19 first emerged, official figures show around 90% of the population nationwide has been vaccinated, but only 38% of the more vulnerable, those over 60 in Shanghai, have the full protection of 3 vaccinations. So it is quite crazy what is going on there. I'm still shocked. It seems almost like really draconian, and like me even being in Canada and being in the US, just going on that trip I did like a couple weeks ago, it's like life is normal again. It really is. There's no masks. There's, you know, no one's asking for your vaccine passport. You know, flying, there's no masks. Going back home, I don't need to take a PCR test or home. I don't have to take any tests to go back into Canada. It's really crazy, right? Like, to see that people are still freaking out about this in China like that. And I was just like, wow, I I'm not going to force anyone to, you know, wear a mask or whatever or do those different things. But, you know, we're learning to live with it more than anything else. And it's not as bad as people think. Actually, right now, for my age group, if you guys are like in like the, was it like the 18, is it 18 or like 20s to 40s? 20s to 50s or whatever, you have a higher chance of dying from the flu than dying from the coronavirus right now. So you guys should be more fair. You guys should be getting flu shots, if anything else. But it's crazy that they're doing zero COVID policy. I still can't believe that this type of stuff is like, people are freaking out even this much. I don't know, like the WHO said, how sustainable this will be. Like markets, like inflation and economy is terrible around the world. And they're basically just making it worse in one of the biggest, largest cities in the world. So that is the top 3 news in the world right now. So we're going to get into some sporting news. NBA playoffs, 2 games yesterday. We had the Miami Heat defeating the Philadelphia 76ers. Well, they weren't just defeating. They crushed them by 35 points, 120 to 85. Miami is now 1 game away of winning the series. The series is 3-2. Jimmy Butler had 23 points, 9 rebounds, 6 assists. In the losing effort, Embiid and Harden. Okay, like this sounds like a stat that Embiid or Harden can do in a single game, but this is Embiid and Harden combined were 31 points, 11 rebounds, 6 assists. That's combined. So it was a terrible game by the 2 best players on the team. In the other game in the West, it was the Phoenix Suns, the number 1 team, Phoenix Suns, defeating the Dallas Mavericks 110-80, which means that's another 30-point game, and now Phoenix takes control, also leading the series 3-2, Devin Booker with 28 points and 7 rebounds, Luka Doncic had 28 points and 11 rebounds. Oh, and for those of you guys don't know, there was awards for the 2021-22 season for the NBA. The MVP goes to Nikola Jokic from the Denver Nuggets. Best coach of the year was Monty Williams from the Phoenix Suns. Sixth man of the year is Tyler Hero from the Heat. The most improved player was Ja Morant from the Memphis Grizzlies, who is now currently injured for the rest of the playoffs. The Rookie of the Year, Scotty Barnes from Toronto, and Defensive Player of the Year was Marcus Smart from the Boston Celtics. And all these teams made it into the playoffs. In NHL playoff games, you know, all the series were tied at 2-2. So, you know, four teams got into control yesterday. Carolina Hurricanes defeat the Boston Bruins 5-1. So they're up 3-2, one game away from clinching. Well, all the teams here who won yesterday are one game away from clinching the series. Toronto beats Tampa Bay 4-3. St. Louis defeats Minnesota 5-2. And the LA Kings defeat the Edmonton Oilers 5-4. And all of those teams are now leading the series 3-2. In NFL news, some crazy, crazy news came out. Tom Brady, he's going to be playing next season for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. But he's already signed an agreement to be a color commentator for Fox Sports. And it's 10 years and $375 million. Now, that's pretty crazy, guys, because this is actually probably better than any other, you know, quarterback, because no one has a 10-year contract, right? 10 years, $375 million. Just to give you an idea of how big that is, Tom Brady, in his 22 years as a quarterback in the NFL, made $331 million. He is going to make more than that in less than half the time. 10 years, $375 million, which means, like, think about this, guys. That's $37.5 million a year. Before this contract, the highest paid sports commentator was Jim Rome, and he gets $30 million a year. And this guy's someone who's worked in the industry for 32 years, and he's got the highest following, okay? Then after that is Tony Romo and Troy Aikman with $18 million each. And here is Tom Brady, never done any commentating ever. He's got a big following on social media. However, he's getting paid more than Jim Rome, who's been doing it for over three decades, and more than Romo and Aikman, who both, he's getting paid more than double of both of them. So this should be quite interesting to see how he does. And he's going to be, you know, with a contract like that, he will be scrutinized a lot. So we'll see what's going to happen. Honestly, just to listen to him speak, I would actually watch games just to listen to him commentate on it too. But either way, so that is top three news in sports and current news from around the world. Hope you guys really enjoyed that. So let's get into a really spiritual time. It is the golden time. It is a time of praise and worship to the Holy Trinity. Got a couple songs here for you. Today, we can sing together and give praise and glory. First, it is History of the Lord and the Holy Spirit. And then Let's Overcome the World. And then we'll end things off with Close to the Holy Spirit. All right? So as one body of the Morning Star Drive, let's spend this time giving praise, honor, and glory to the Holy Trinity.
Take action. People follow what you do. spirit's history. Act with faith to the end, fearless and bold. We've achieved victory. Heaven above is before us. Give your everything, hope, will, and life. One with the Lord, you will triumph and win. We've destroyed the demons, and now glory has come after victory. We've achieved victory. Heaven of love is before us. Give your everything, hope, will, and life. One with the Lord, you will triumph and win. We've destroyed the demons, and now glory has come after victory. We've achieved victory. Heaven of love is before us. Give your everything, hope, will, and life. One with the Lord, you will triumph and win. We've destroyed the demons, and now glory has come after victory. Rapture's love shall last.
Chips and send our fears away. Come from our hearts and send with the wind. On the wind of the Spirit, let your cares fly. You and I both, we must go on. Our hearts have not changed. Like the waves rising and falling, we may waver and be shaken, nevertheless. As one, we go on as one. We must support, help each other, care for each other as we love and adore only God, the Holy Spirit. We will look up to them, longing for heaven. Overcome our hardships and send our fears away. Come from our hearts and sent with the wind. On the wind of the Spirit, let your cares fly. You and I both, we must go on. Our hearts have not changed. Thank you.
when she moves your heart, then you'll become closer to your Holy Spirit, Goddess of holiness, purity, and love, as a clean bride be adorned with purity.
Holy Spirit. Hope you guys really enjoyed that time of praise and worship. Let's Overcome the World and History of the Lord and the Holy Spirit before that too. Now that our hearts are kind of in that spiritual zone after that time of praise and worship, let's get into today's Q&A Thursday. We have really two really good questions today, and I hope it's something that all of us can learn more and more from. And I hope that if you do have some questions, I can't answer every question, obviously, but there are some that I know what Sunseem's talked about, or, you know, I've been teaching for like 20 some odd years. So some things I do understand a lot better. So here's that first question about Matthew 27:50-54. Very, very big one. This is when Jesus died. And he gives up his spirit. And then the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook. There was an earthquake. Rocks split, right? And then the tombs broke open. Bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. And then, of course, it says when the centurion or those who with him were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Okay, so let's first get into the first question was, what has Sunseem talked about these verses? Okay, so number one is verse 50 says that Jesus cried out in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. So that one's kind of obvious. He died at that point in his spirit, you know, he gave up his spirit. Okay, now at that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Okay, so we have to understand that this is symbolism here. Okay, so if you go into like any other Jewish people will talk about, no, this never happened. There wasn't an earthquake, or there could have been an earthquake, but they're like, no, and the curtains of the temple were never torn, right? We never felt an earthquake. So they could actually deny it and say that, oh my gosh, this is like all terrible. The Bible is like talking these false truths. Now, could they be lying? That's true too. But let's take a look at the symbolic meaning that Sunseem has talked about when he talks about the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. So what are these curtains? So when you look at the temple of God in Jerusalem, remember there's an outer court, inner court, and then the outer court, which is where the Gentiles are. Then you have the inner court, okay? And then you have, you go into the temple. You have to go through the curtain, which leads into the temple, right? The holy place. And then there's the holiest of holy places, which is in the center. And that place has another curtain that's only for those that are, you know, only for the chief priest that goes in once a year to talk to God, all right? So first, you have to understand the symbolism of a curtain. So the symbolism of curtain is the same as what we'd have today called a door. It's a doorway, or they call it the threshold, okay? And that threshold is the line between one place and another place, right? And those two curtains inside the temple of God, one is the curtain or the doorway or the threshold that goes into the holy place. And then you have the second curtain, which goes into the holiest of holy places, okay? So the symbolism of the curtain tearing from top to bottom, what is that symbolizing? Well, it is a threshold to get into the holy place, okay? So if you look at the temple of God, there's three main areas. There is the inner court, right, where people, you know, all the regular people, all the Jews can come in, and they bring in their sacrifices, whatever it is. And then the priests are the only ones allowed into the holy place, right? They get to pass through the curtain, and only the Levites, only the priests can go through that threshold into the holy place. And then you have the chief priest, the chief of all the priests is the only one that can go into the holiest of holies and can cross through that curtain, okay? So what does this symbolism mean? Well, if you take a look at the way that the temple of God works, the inner court is the Old Testament. Okay, the holy place is for the priests, which is the New Testament, and then the holiest of holies is the most intimate place, which is the complete Testament time. So what happened at the time of Jesus was what? At the time of Jesus, he's the one that dies on the cross, and then what happens? He allows people to resurrect and become children of God. Okay, which means that when you resurrect to become the child of God, you are allowed to go into the second part. So you're able to cross the threshold of relationship. Okay, so in the Old Testament time, all the people, the regular people, were only allowed in the inner court, and that's it. They couldn't cross into the holy place. But the symbolism is that curtain tearing, which means that the regular people who accept Jesus are now able to cross the threshold into the New Testament time or into the holy place. Okay, so that is a symbolism of the curtain being torn, which means that threshold is no longer covered, but now, since we believe in Jesus, we can cross into the holy place like priests. And this is why you'll find verses in the Bible that talk about us being the ministers of a new covenant, right? The covenant of Melchizedek. And you'll find that in Hebrews chapter, you know, I haven't done Bible studies in a long time. I think it's in Hebrews chapter 5, I think. No, it's not chapter 5. Oh, it is chapter 5. And, no, it's not chapter 5. Oh, wow. You know, I'm gonna have to figure this one out, but there's going to, you know, give me 1 second. New Covenant, Priests of a New Covenant, and we'll take a look at this from the New Testament. So, it's 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6, that says, Jesus has made us competent as ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, right? So we are now ministers of a new covenant, not of the Old Testament, but of the new, and that tearing of the curtain is symbolic of us being able to enter the holy place. If we're taking a look at it from the perspective of looking at the temple of God. Okay, and of course, if you take a look at the second coming tears the curtain for the holiest of holies, which is the most intimate place, which is the most intimate relationship between man and God, which is the husband and wife, right? So that's for verse 51. Okay, the earth shook and the rocks split. And that is symbolism. That is also symbolism. The earth shaking is the foundation. And whenever Sunseem talks about when the Messiah comes, this is, you know, it's not just in Matthew 27, but in Matthew 24, 2 talks about great natural disasters or earthquakes. And whenever Sunseem talks about an earthquake, the foundation is broken, which means like it's no, you know, people who are thinking in the Old Testament time have to rethink and their foundations are shaken and broken. Which means it's a time to move into the new time, okay? Now, the tombs were broken open. It does not mean, physically speaking, the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. And this is basically meaning that because of Jesus dying for all these people, they were now all able to enter into the New Testament time, all the people that were waiting for Jesus. Okay, so they came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection. They went into the holy city and appeared to many people. And of course, if they appeared to every single person in Jerusalem, then there would have been reports everywhere that, oh my gosh, I saw David, I saw Abraham. But that wasn't the case too. And this is why Jews will refute this and say, well, no, don't you think if these dead people came to life that everyone would follow Jesus because they'd be like, oh my gosh, we saw all of our dead relatives, this, right? So it is a spiritual occurrence. So even when it says the centurion saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and said he was the son of God. Most likely their spiritual eyes were open at that time, right? So this is what Sunseem's kind of talked about with these different verses. And when it says 1 Corinthians 15:20, Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. So you want to take a look at Christ from the Holy Son's branch entity. Jesus himself was someone from the Old Testament, right? So then when we look at the bonche and the bunche, right? The original entity is from the Holy Trinity, but we're looking at the branch entity, which is the human, right? So the human had to be raised and trained and made, right? So that's like Hebrews chapter 5, verses 7 through 9, that, you know, he went through all the trainings and he was once made perfect, then became the source of eternal life, right? So what was happening is all those people who believed in Jesus became children of God. Right, they all became children of God. They resurrected and changed. Now, what does it mean in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 20? It means that Jesus is the first from the Old Testament to cross into the New Testament time. So everyone in the Old Testament time is considered to be fallen asleep, and everyone in the New Testament time is considered to be awake to the new times. So Christ was raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. He was the first to cross into the New Testament time, being raised by the Holy Son's original entity. Okay, so these people that were raised from the dead from verse 52 and 53, who were they? Were they people, spirits who died before Jesus? And yes, they were all people who died before Jesus who were waiting for him. Okay. And now that they believe, now how did they believe? When we understand, like we might not be able to teach newcomers this way, but what we understand and know is when people believe, even in this time right now, when we teach the word, many spirits are listening to us teach and preach the word also. So when, you know, when you're teaching one-on-one to a newcomer, it's not one-on-one. It's like 1 on 50, 1 on 100, 1 on 1,000, depending how many people are listening to that lecture, right? So that means that many people, even in the Old Testament time, were listening to the words that Jesus was preaching. right? They were following their ancestors, following their descendants, whatever it was, and listening to the words as they listened also. And as they listened to the word, when, you know, when Jesus died, that kind of was the time when everything broke open, right? And the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life, which means these are physical holy people who had died. They were raised to life, okay? So that's what it means there. Yeah, these are people, spirits who died before Jesus, okay? So the other people, they're the people who are still living, like Peter and Paul and James and John, whatever it is, they're spiritually alive, of course, because they believe in Jesus, right? They believed, right? So they're spiritually alive already, but the spirits that came out were actually spirits of old, okay? And then the last question for this one for resurrection lecture is in relation to Isaiah 26 verse 19 that says, but your dead will live, Lord, their bodies will rise. Let those who dwell in dust wake up and shout for joy. Your dew is like the dew of the morning. The earth will give birth to her dead, which is obviously talking about the spiritual, those that have the spirits of those that have died. Okay. And which basically, well, you know, it's all about the spirit, because remember, we know that resurrection is not about the body anymore, right? So when it says your dead will live, it's twofold, right? It's twofold. First is those who are living already, their spirits are resurrecting and coming back to life because they believe in Jesus. And number two is those that have already died, right? They are coming back to life as they listen to the words and as, you know, they believe. So you're seeing two different types of, you know, two different settings of people that are coming back to life. Those that are already living and those that have already died. And that would be the exact same thing as the rapture too, right? So in the rapture, remember, rapture is resurrection. Rapture is the last resurrection. So when you look at like 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verses like 16 and 17, 17 is a key. It's 16 is a key. It says, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together, right? So even rapture talks about two different types of resurrections or raptures. One is the people who have already died in Christ, right? They're the ones that believe and listening to the word. And then secondly is going to be the people who are still living, right? So both of them are talking about the spirit. Right? Both the people who have already died, their spirits will resurrect. And those who are living, listening to the words and believing, their spirits will resurrect too. Right? So in that prophecy in Isaiah chapter 26, verse 19 shows that it is a spiritual matter, not a physical matter. Okay? So I hope this helps you out with the resurrection lecture. And if you have any more questions or things that you might not be absolutely clear about, go ahead and text me. You know who you are. That is a great question. Okay? So let's get into the second question today. Second question is about this really crazy verse in the Bible. It's in the book of Deuteronomy and chapter 22, verse 28 and 29. And it says, if a man happens to meet a virgin who is not pledged to be married and rapes her, and they are discovered, he shall pay her father 50 shekels of silver. He must marry the woman, for he has violated her. He can never divorce her as long as he lives. Okay? So very, very crazy thing here. And the question is, well, how can God make this raped woman be sold? There's one, sold. And the second one has to marry the man who raped her, right? So those are two things that are really like, oh my goodness. Number one, she is sold. And number two, she has to marry the man that raped her. So it's like, wow, like, I don't get it. What does it mean? And of course, it is quite shocking, right? When you think about it from today's perspective, especially, and that's the one thing that we do need to separate is, you don't want to look at it from today's perspective, because today's perspective is so much different than the past. And today we are much more sensitive to these things, these issues in life. And of course, we're like, oh my gosh, it's such a big thing. And the answer is it's a big thing today, but not as big in the past. Right? And what I mean by this is we are much more comfortable in life and we are able to focus on the more details and the smaller things, right? Things that are beyond survival. So what you have to think about is if you put yourself to 6,000 or even 2,000 years ago, right? You got to kind of imagine what life was like when you could die any day, anytime. Women were dying at a much earlier age. And that's why even even at the time of Jesus 2,000 years ago. So we're talking this, Deuteronomy is like 4,000 years ago, right? So even 2,000 years ago, women were being married at 12, 13 years old. The moment they were menstruating, the moment they were able to have babies is the moment they were pledged to be married. And they were marrying people twice their age, right? Because people were dying a lot earlier, right? And this is why they these women were married a lot earlier. And that's even at Jesus's time. Right? So imagine if you go further in time, 3,000, 4,000 years ago, people are dying earlier, people are dying during pregnancy, people are dying from disease. The age of when you die, the average age of living is much lower than it is today, right? So imagine you live in a life when you could die, you know, much earlier than you do today. Would you care about other people's feelings? And the answer is probably not. If you even go further to like caveman times, it's all about survival, right? If it's about survival, would you marry the person you love, or would you marry the person that can keep you living, like the strongest person in the village, right? No, you'd actually be caring more about survival, right? Only now, when things are safer, when things are better now, this is when we are not thinking more about survival, right? Like right now, we have a choice of how many babies we want to have. Back then, you don't have a choice. You want to have multiple babies because you don't know how many of them are going to survive, right? Right now, we have a choice. I only want one baby. We have contraceptives. We have like surgeries and stuff that stop people from having babies. We can choose, but back then, it's about survival, right? It's about being with the strongest, being in the strongest tribe. It's not about who's the prettiest. It's not about who's, you know, who's the fastest or whatever like this. It was very much about survival. Okay, so that's the first thing we have to do, is change the perspective that we're thinking from. Because it sounds pretty bad that the Bible's saying that if you get raped, you know, then you should be like this. So here's the thing. Why does the Bible talk about someone raping a virgin and then have to pay the father for it? Is that really fair? And then all of a sudden they have to marry. So your answer is actually going to be in Exodus chapter 22, verse 16 and 17. And I want you to know that it's not quite what you think it is. Yes, we read in Deuteronomy, this is a rule, and it is a rule, and it's something that people do follow. However, it's not as cut and dry as you think. Okay, and one of the answers, we're going to take a look at the book of Exodus 2, which talks about a very, very similar situation. And this is Exodus chapter 22, verse 16 and 17. And this talks about... What is the possibilities, right? Does she have to marry this person who raped her, okay? So in verse 16, it says, if a man seduces a virgin who is not pledged to be married and sleeps with her, he must pay the bride price and she shall be his wife. Now here's the key. Verse 17 is the key. If her father absolutely refuses to give her to him, he still must pay the bride price for virgins, okay? So here's the thing. When we look at this, this passage we just read clearly states that if a man has sex with a virgin who is not pledged to be married, regardless of rape or consensual, he is obliged to marry her. And she, you know, and of course, he should have originally sought her father's permission to do this, right? Negotiated a bride price and taken her as his wife. And because he didn't do this, he is punished for this. And he now must pay up, right? And he can't, this is a thing. He has to pay no matter what. He cannot opt out of it, right? And he must marry her. And in turn, in that day, is a major punishment, right? Because you have no choice. This could be a major punishment in that day, right? Because it was a foolish thing, a spur of the moment act of passion or whatever it was, even though she really wasn't the right woman for him, he has no choice from this point on, which means it's kind of like a punishment. However, in the end, it is her father who is ultimately the authority in this situation as the head of the household. So until the father hands this authority over to her husband, he cannot take her as his wife. Right? So it has to be ultimately from the father. And if the father says, I refuse, no matter what, this man has to pay the bride price, the virgin price. Right? So you got to think about that. How many fathers would give their daughter to a rapist? And honestly, not many. So in general, a rapist would actually have to pay a 50 silver shekel fine to her father. and not get a wife at all. So that's why, you know, part of it is you need to kind of look at the full situation of what the full scope of what the Bible is actually saying, right? So the answer to the question is, does she have to marry him? And the answer is no. It actually depends on the father, because the father is the head of the household. And remember, back then, it's much different than now. Like right now, you'd be like, well, I don't have to do what my father says. But back then, you did. That's the culture. The father was the head. You listened to exactly what the father said, right? So I know you might complain and say that, oh, but that's so terrible. And like, not really, because that's what they believed back then, right? And if you look at throughout the Old Testament, no rape victim has ever been recorded as being forced to marry a rapist. No, it's never happened like that. It is plausible, right? Because there are some circumstances in which the father would choose to have his daughter marry a rapist, right? So in 2 Samuel chapter 13, Amnon, the son of King David, rapes his half-sister Tamar. Tamar was not forced to marry Amnon, but interestingly, Tamar seemed to have wanted to marry Amnon after the rape. Right? So why would she desire such a thing? Because in that, so let's take a look at culturally now too. In that culture, virginity was highly prized. It would have been very difficult for a woman who was not a virgin, and especially a woman who had been raped, to find a man to marry her. So it seems that Tamar would have rather married Amnon than live desolate and single the rest of her life, which is what eventually happened to her, right? So Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 28, 29 could be viewed as more merciful to the woman, right? Especially in those times. You might think, oh, it's not fair. But in that time, it was more merciful because virginity was so highly prized. And if they did not marry, it would be so hard for that woman to find a man to marry her, right? So in that culture, it is actually mercy towards that woman. Unmarried women often had no choice but to sell themselves into slavery or prostitution just to survive. And this is why the passage leaves marriage to the discretion of the father, because every situation is different and it's better to be flexible than have a blanket rule. So, you know, we have to understand is, number one is, is the woman being sold? And the answer is not really, because back in that time, it wasn't like you're selling your daughter. It's the price you pay to take the daughter away from the family, right? And that's something that's quite cultural, even to like several hundred years ago when there were dowries paid. Because think about it, you have a woman in your family that's doing work and all these other different things, and to lose that person, right? You're down one person, and this is why the wife or the woman will leave their family and join the husband's family, right? So now that this father is losing someone, they get compensated for that, right? So is it being sold? Today we might look at it that way, but no, it's not like that. It's not being sold. Back in those days, it was normal cultural thing, right? And it makes sense too. So this is why you want to take a look at the full scripture, the embodiment. Look at Exodus chapter 22 also, but it shows you that no, they didn't have to, but it was seen more as a merciful thing, right? Because once that virginity is gone, no one's going to marry her. She will have no way to take care of herself. And like, you know, how sad would it be if because of that raping that now you have to go into slavery or prostitution just to survive, which is really, really sad at that time, right? So I do hope it's something that we can understand culturally speaking from 3,000-4,000 years ago. And it's not, you know, this paying of a dowry. If you look up a dowry is something that was used even in England, right? Where, you know, you have to pay a certain amount of money to take the daughter away as a gift to the family for giving their daughter to you, right? And, you know, today women are a lot more independent where you don't have to listen to your parents. But back then you did have to listen to your parents, right? So I hope it's something that now you understand much better when it comes to culturally what is happening at that time, okay? And like I said, even before that, like if you're going to be like, oh, how come as a father has so much authority? Well, that's the culture back then. Of course, you have to look at Eve's sin that brought woman below man and stuff like that too. But that's for another topic, okay? So that is the Q&A Thursday for today. Hope it's something that you guys really enjoyed. And if you have any other questions, go ahead, write them in the comments. Would love to hear what you guys are, some other questions that you guys have too. Okay, so that brings us into song of choice for today on this Well, it's Thursday, which means it is Boy Band Thursday, right? It is Boy Band Thursday, one of my favorite days of the week. And I'm going to choose a song that's one of my... this is a song I used to sing in karaoke a lot, too, because it was so perfect. Back in 1999, I used to sing this a lot when there was a lot of persecution at that time, too. It's from a boy band called Boyzone. They have this song called No Matter What, and it's like the theme song of people in faith and the persecution they go through. You guys have to listen to the lyrics. It's crazy good. This song is called No Matter What. Listen to the lyrics. It's so good. It'll make you like, it'll strengthen your faith more than anything else. So this is Boyzone with No Matter What.
No matter what they tell us, no matter what they do, no matter what they teach us, what we believe is true. No matter what they call us, however they attack, we'll find our own way back. I can't deny what I believe. I can't be what I'm not. I know I love forever. I know no matter what. If only tears were laughter, was day, if only prayers were answered, then we would hear God say. No matter what they tell you, no matter what they do, no matter what they teach you, what you believe is true. And I will keep you safe and strong, shelter from the storm.
that's all that matters to me.
And there it is. That is Boy Band Thursday, Boy Zone with No Matter What. Tell me, guys, what did you think about the lyrics? Isn't it powerful? Like, if you really listen to the lyrics, it's like, wow, that is a great song for people who are going through persecution and difficult times. But I hope you guys are really inspired by that more than anything else. Okay, so that is a song of choice for today on that Boy Band Thursday. Hope you guys really enjoyed that, which leads us into the last segment for today. And today's last segment is the thoughts of the week. And we're going to talk about the fear of God. Okay, and it's a little bit different because I know the fear of God sounds like, oh my gosh, should I fear God or whatnot? But this came from the word study we did yesterday on Patreon. So if you're on Patreon, you can go ahead and check out the word study. But we went really deep because a lot of the big questions that people ask for is, what can I do? What do I need to change? How can I become someone that God helps, right? And one thing that, these are my thoughts of, one thing I really noticed is that people in Providence tend to think about, you know, of course, action is the most important thing. However, we kind of take it too far when we think to ourselves that God will not love me if I don't take action. You know what I mean? There's this fear that, oh, if I don't go to pre-dawn, God won't love me. Oh, if I don't do this, then God won't love me. And it becomes this thing where it almost becomes, once again, like a master-servant relationship where we're trying to impress God so that God will do something or just be normal to us. And it becomes this, we have this kind of fear that's a little bit different than the fear between a husband and a wife. Is there fear between a husband and a wife? Absolutely. But it's not the same fear as, I'm scared this person's going to beat me up, or I'm scared this person's going to leave me. It's not that type of fear, right? Because there's this healthy type of fear we should always have. Because if you have that fear, what does that mean? It means that that little bit of fear in our hearts will stop us from doing really bad things, right? Because I love my wife so much, I don't want to hurt her. That's different than, oh my gosh, she's going to beat me up. Oh, she's going to leave me any single moment. No, that's a different type of fear. That's probably not even a marriage. It shouldn't be based on that type of fear. But it's almost like you have that fear inside because you love someone so much, you don't want to hurt them, right? And what I see is a lot of times we're looking for, what can I do to make God love me more? What can I do so that God will help me more in this week's message? And the one thing that we have to, we have to look at this as the key fundamental thing that we have to make sure we keep in our hearts, and it's something that is the foundation of our faith, is not about what can I do. We need to understand that the Old Testament time was a time of just action. It wasn't about your faith or your heart. It was about, what did you do, right? So you didn't murder, you're not a murderer. But then when you get to New Testament, it's like, if you even hate, you're a murderer, which has to do with, it's not only just not doing it, but you can't feel it in your heart. It was a much more deeper spiritual thing, right? However, complete testament is both of them combined. It's about not doing it plus, right, having that faith, right? That's why the New Testament time is a time of faith. And what we need to understand is complete testament is building on top of the Old Testament and New Testament combined. Why is it that right now that God is going to help us? We have to think about that. What is the ultimate answer? Why is God going to help us this week? Why? And when you look at the answer that Sunseem gave, it wasn't, oh, because you did this and you did this and you did this. No, it was the condition, the great condition was set by the Lord. That's the ultimate answer. He set the condition, and this is why you're being helped. It's not all the other stuff of what I did. Right? Because the moment you start thinking that it's because of all the things I did, then you start to think of God, like, then we get complaining, get angry at God as, well, I deserve this because I did this for you, because I did this, you have to do this for me. And our minds can get caught into that area where we forget it's not the biggest condition for salvation, for rapture, for God meeting us and helping us today is because of the Lord. That's how big the Lord is, the man of mission, the person that God sent. That's how big the Messiah is. Salvation at the time of Jesus, impossible without him doing the sacrifice. Impossible. Right? And when we realize this, we have to understand the number one and most important thing that we have to kind of recognize as that stable, strong, sturdy foundation is not what have I done, is what has the Lord done for me? Think about it. If it was based on what we did, then how many of us would receive salvation? Right? Then there wouldn't be a message of repay the grace, because God wouldn't even give us the grace unless we did something first. But what we know is God gave the grace first, and now we need to pay that back. It's different than, oh, well, you did a bunch of things and that's why I'm going to save you. No, it's got nothing to do with that. People have to recognize how important it is that we have the Lord and the Lord set the condition for us. Why will God meet with us? Because of the Lord's condition. Why are we raptured? Because of the Lord's condition. Why are we saved? Because of the Lord's condition. That is a fundamental basis for all things. The moment we start thinking that oh, God punished me because I did this. Oh, God doesn't like me because I missed one pre-dawn. That becomes a very unhealthy fear. Very unhealthy fear. We have to keep in mind the whole reason why we're doing these things, why we're in the position we're at. And if we forget what the Lord has done, what God has done for us, we become less thankful. We become more of you owe me. Oh, why did this bad thing happen to me? And we start blaming God and complaining. And why is it, oh, this is a providence. Why is it like, no, we have to change the way that we think. And whether it's us teaching newcomers or it's about, you know, us reminding members, the ultimate thing before all things is what has God done for us? What is all, remember the grace God has given you. If you think back at all the times God has saved you, all the times God has given you grace, all the times God has done amazing things for you, look at it honestly. What did you do to deserve that? It is purely out of love. Purely. And if you become someone who doesn't like God or starts to turn away or starts to cool down in your faith, do you think God is sitting there saying, oh, well forget you then. Forget you. Go, leave, fine. No. God is the opposite. That's what human beings would do. God is even more working to open your eyes, to show how much he loves you even more, to say, no, this is how much I love you. God's different than us. And we have to recognize and realize, wow, God is not like a human being. He's just going to ditch people. The only time you see God actually abandoning people is when people go so extreme to the point they are like, you know, there's situations where some guy just comes in and starts falling with everyone, right? Doesn't repent. And God gives them multiple chances, but they're just hurting too many other people that there's no choice but to kick them out. Or someone who's murdering people constantly, you know, it's got to reach a certain extreme. But when you look at the regular person like us, when our faith cools down, we're not doing as well as we did before. God's not sitting there abandoning you, saying that, oh, you're not doing, really? Then forget that. I'm not going to work with you. No, God's so different. God is the one who's saying, wow, they really need more help. Let me help you. Oh, they really need more. Yeah, you know what? It's the same thing as us. Think about this. God loves us more than we love ourselves and more than we love each other. The love in this world is nothing compared to God's love. If your child doesn't like you, do you ditch your child? And the answer is no way. You try to love them more. When they're going through a difficult time, when they're disobedient, when they're struggling in school, whatever it is, do we ditch them? Do we say, no, well, you're messed up. I'm not going to work with you anymore. No, we try to do even more for them. We do even more. And we have to think about is we're human and our love is pretty powerful because we can even die for each other. But it's nothing compared to God's love. God is relentless in his love. And it's because of that love, we've received so much grace, we've been saved. And that has to be the ultimate thing. Even remember rapture? When we were in 2015, 2014 and 13, we're learning about rapture, 100 line, 200 line. What was the basics of rapture? It was three things. Number one is believe in God. That is such a big thing. To believe in God is such a huge thing, Sunstein said. It's like putting like hundreds of thousands of dollars straight into your bank account the moment you believe in God. That's how big it is just to believe. And then the second thing is, like, for the basics, is to believe in the one he has sent. And last but not least is, well, if you believe in the one he has sent, you're going to listen to his word. So listen to the word and put it into action. Those three are the three ultimate things, the basics, right, of what we can do for what God sees as such a big thing. The moment we start thinking that I have to do something for God to do something for me, oh, the relationship changes. The dynamic of the relationship actually changes. Right? Haven't you ever gotten caught up into that before? Where it's like someone buys you food and you want to buy them back, and then you just keep buying each other food back and forth. And it's kind of like it was never meant to be. I pay, you pay, I pay, you pay, I pay, you pay. It never meant to be that. It was just, I really like you and I want to pay for your food, so I'm going to pay for your food. It never meant to get into one of those situations where you're constantly paying for each other. And it was never meant to be that way. But sometimes we get caught up into those things. I pay you, you pay me back. Okay, I pay you. Okay, you pay me back. Yeah. And I hope it's something that we can think about our relationship with God, that is not going to be based in that transactional of I do for you, so why aren't you doing this for me? No, this is love. Love is different. Love does not calculate. Love is not thinking, you bought these two things for me, so now I have to buy two things for you. Oh God, no. Because when we love, it's like, God, I'm doing this for you because I love you. That's it. There's nothing, no strings attached. That's it. And we have to realize to that level. So I hope it's something that all of us can really get our hearts and our minds to wrap around and understand at that level. This is something that God really, really is, really wants us to know even more. And I pray that all of us too will really think about our foundation of faith again, right? That we have a healthy fear of God. And we'll be able to just recognize once again, we can be so thankful because we realize right now, God is helping us because of Son's name. Right now, we are raptured because of the Lord. Right now, we are saved because of the Lord. Everything else is small compared to that. Without that, nothing happens. Okay? So that's the thoughts of my week, thoughts of the week today. And I hope you guys really enjoyed that. You know, put a comment below if it's something that you really liked or inspired by. If not, it's okay. You know, you don't have to comment if you don't want to. But everyone, enjoy your day. And we'll see you guys again tomorrow on the Morning Star Drive on 117.8.
It's the Morning Star Drive 117.8. You soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my